Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine. Milton, pot of thieves, wild cord on my sleeve. Thick, heart of stone, my sins my own, they belong to me, me.
It was ground zero for rock music and debauchery. From mafia connections to Charles Manson to 80s heavy metal and beyond, the Whisky A Go-Go has a wild past. The founder of the Whisky A Go-Go, Elmer Valentine, was born in Chicago, enlisted in the Air Force, and fought in World War II. After leaving the military, he returned to the Windy City to work as a police officer. But Valentine had a shady side gig. He told Vanity Fair, "I used to moonlight running nightclubs for the outfit, for gangsters. The law caught up to him, and he was charged with extortion. The charges didn't stick, but Chicago was getting too hot, so Valentine headed west. He landed in Los Angeles in 1960 and put his nightclub experience to use, opening a club named PJ's. The club attracted attention when up-and-coming singer-songwriter Trini Lopez recorded a live album there, which became a commercial success. Valentine knew the nightclub business was for him, but he wasn't sure about LA. So in 1963, he sold his share of PJs and went to Europe in search of inspiration. In Paris, he stumbled upon a nightclub called the Whisky A Go-Go that was packed with young people on a nightly basis. Valentine returned to the US with a big idea. In the early 1960s, the Sunset Strip was no longer happening the way it had been during Hollywood's golden age. But that all changed when Elmer Valentine came home with a plan to replicate the success of the Whisky A Go-Go in America. Valentine set up shop on Sunset Boulevard in a club called The Party that had seen better days. The Whisky A Go-Go officially opened in 1964. But in order to attract a crowd, Valentine needed an act. He came upon a talented young singer-songwriter named Johnny Rivers, who later achieved considerable fame for his song Secret Agent Man. Rivers was the house act at the nearby club Gazzari's. Valentine was instantly infatuated with his sound and the fact that it brought him plenty of customers. Valentine's friend, record producer Lou Adler, convinced him to offer Rivers a residency at the Whisky. Rivers accepted and became a regular at the venue, bringing his growing fan base with him. Word of mouth spread quickly, and the Whisky soon became a hotspot for budding rock and roll acts. Within its first year, the Whisky garnered national attention, becoming the hangout for Tinseltown royalty like Steve McQueen and Jane Mansfield. Johnny Rivers recalled, "Everybody was there. I mean, you'd look up and there was Cary Grant dancing." But the Whisky didn't just appeal to American celebrities. When the Beatles embarked on their first tour of the United States, they made time to visit the club. The Whisky earned a reputation as a place where inhibitions were optional, with racy stories involving the Beatles, English actor James Mason, and Mansfield that are too spicy to talk about. The Doors were another of the Whisky's house acts. Although band members Jim Morrison and Ray Manzarek, who were studying film at UCLA at the time, were initially reluctant to join the Sunset Strip scene. Manzarek told Vanity Fair, "The Whisky was for Hollywood swingers. It was the antithesis of everything artistic that you could imagine. Everyone derided it. And then we wind up being the house band there. How ironic life is."
The Doors opening for Johnny Rivers.
While Morrison's drug and alcohol-fueled exploits eventually got them banned from the club, they only enhanced its reputation as a venue where anything could happen. During the 1960s, the Whisky inspired its share of trends. When Johnny Rivers performed at the club, a young female DJ played records between sets in a transparent enclosure, elevated above the dancing patrons. Because the venue wasn't terribly big, special accommodations had to be made to allow room for both a stage and a DJ booth. Elmer Valentine knew how unique the setup was, and arranged a contest to hire a hip young lady to fill the role. They found a winner. But her mother refused to let her do it, so Valentine hired his cigarette girl, Patty Brockhurst, for the gig, and accidentally kicked off one of the defining dance crazes of the 1960s. You see, Brockhurst was hired as a DJ, but her habit of dancing to the music she spun turned into something much bigger. As Valentine told Vanity Fair, she had on a slit skirt, and we put her up there. So she's up there playing the records. She's a young girl, so while she's playing them, all of a sudden she starts dancing to them. It was a dream. It worked. Knowing that this would help put the Whisky on the map, Valentine quickly had two more platforms built and hired more dancers to occupy them.
And here's the world-famous Whisky A Go-Go on the Strip, a favorite dancing spot for both the mods and movie stars who want to get it on.
Though Elmer Valentine had pretty much left his shady dealings behind in Chicago, some of his old mobster connections followed him out to sunny Southern California when news of the Whisky's success got back to them. Some of the old gang showed up at the Whisky and tried to force Johnny Rivers to sign a contract, requiring him to fork over some of his earnings. When Lou Adler stepped in, he was met with a pretty gruesome death threat. Luckily, Valentine showed up to defuse the situation, but he did have to go to Chicago to meet his old connections in person to convince them to lay off. Valentine rarely flexed his mob muscles, but he wasn't afraid to when it was called for. Notorious hitman Felix Anthony Milwaukee Phil Aldericio was a buddy of Valentine, who employed his, quote, help from time to time. For example, rival establishment Gazzeri's was so bothered when the Whisky hijacked Rivers from them that the owner sent one of his connections, Charles Carmen Inglesia, aka Chucky English, to threaten Valentine into giving back Rivers. Valentine had Aldericio, quote, respond for him, and the matter was instantly laid to rest. The Sunset Strip of the early 1960s wasn't the hottest LA neighborhood. That is, not until the Whisky came along and shocked the place back to life. The club's owners worked hard to attract young adults. A Sunset Strip historian told Curbed Los Angeles that one of them noticed some teenagers lingering around Hollywood High School, recalling, he asked them if they would just hang around the Whisky that night, just at the opening, so it looked like something was going on inside. Nearby venues followed suit. So by the mid-60s, the Sunset Strip was no longer just the stomping grounds of Hollywood's old guard. The hippie element had moved in and planted its flag firmly in the territory. However, the sudden and massive influx of youths caused problems for any Sunset Strip business that didn't play live music. They complained of kids engaging in all sorts of degenerate activity and blocking traffic with their antics. One popular club, Pandora's Box, located on a traffic island, was known as the epicenter of underage decadence. It was proposed that the club be torn down, loitering be banned, and a 10 p.m. curfew be implemented. On November 12, 1966, a crowd of young people held a peaceful protest at Pandora's Box. Some fights broke out and numerous arrests were made, but it was a mostly nonviolent affair. Unfortunately, the protest was in vain, and the club was torn down in 1967. The end of the 1960s hippie movement was foreshadowed by the Tate-LaBianca murders in 1969.
One officer summed up the murders when he said, "In all my years, I have never seen anything like this before."
But before Charles Manson attracted worldwide notoriety, he was a musician and songwriter, operating on the fringes of the LA music scene, and a regular at the Whisky a Go-Go. Manson caused quite a stir at the club with his bizarre behavior. In his book Manson, The Life and Times of Charles Manson, author Jeff Gwynn writes, he tipped back his head and threw out his arms. It seemed as though electrical sparks flew from Charlie's fingers and hair. As tolerant as the Whisky was, it couldn't tolerate Manson. The club's co-owner, Mario Maglieri, told Vanity Fair about a time he found Manson hanging around in a booth after hours, saying, "I said, what are you doing here? We're closed. You can't be there." He looked at me and says, "I can have you killed." And I grabbed him, threw him out. I should have strangled that son of a b-. While the Manson family's crimes didn't seriously hurt the Sunset Strip live music scene, after the brutal killings of Sharon Tate and her friends, the psychedelic shimmer of the swinging 60s was noticeably dimmer.
Step inside, Oh, won't you take a little ride? All right, okay, yeah, yeah, hey, hey, what the? All right. Hey, what's your name? How old are you? Where'd you go to school?
It's getting hot!